Hi, my name is Katie Purcell. I'm one of the application engineers here at Achronix, and today I'm going to teach you about our ACE place and route tool. In this video, we are going to go beyond the basics, so come on, it'll be fun. As I mentioned, I'll be going beyond the very basics in this video, so if you are completely new to ACE, I recommend you go back to our video library and check out the Introduction to Achronix FPGA Design Tool Flow training video. In this video, I'm going to make sure you understand the user interface and window layout of the GUI. I'll go over the ACE flow steps, flow options, and advanced features. I'll give you a brief introduction to the IO Designer Toolkit and IP GUI Generator. I'll review the multiprocess flow and show you how it can help you achieve the best performance for your design. And finally, I'll go over some helpful features in our Floorplanner View that are extremely useful when debugging critical timing. Let's review quickly some of the basics. When the ACE GUI is first opened in Project View, you'll see these windows. The Projects window is where you open or create projects, add netlists, constraints, IP files, and manage different implementations. The Flow window shows the different steps in the design flow. You can use this window to pick which flow steps to run, start and stop a flow, and check which steps have already completed. The Options window is where you set the target device, speed grade, as well as other advanced settings. The Tickle console at the bottom allows you to run the design flow and static timing analysis interactively. And the Editor window allows you to view reports and edit project files. As you remember from the introduction video, you can easily create a new project by going to File, Create Project, and specifying where your new project is located. Adding files is simple too. Just right-click on the project and click on Add Project Source Files to add the netlist, timing and placement constraints, or any existing IP files. For setting your basic options, just choose your options in the Options tab, or manually edit the project file. And in the Flow window, you can check which flow steps you want to run, use the Start and Stop buttons to kick off or stop the flow process. Now that we've reviewed the basics again, let's move on to some more advanced options. Now we're going to open up a real ACE project and go through some of the advanced options so you can see how they work. First, let's go over to the Options tab and open up the Advanced Design Preparation. There are many options here. First, we have fanout control. This lets you set the fanout limit on nets. Here we're going to leave it as the default, which is 95. You can choose the resynthesis mode, optimize for timing, optimize for area, or turn it off completely. For this design, we're going to optimize for timing. Moving down, another important feature can be virtual IOs. The virtual IO option is available when testing a portion of the design where top-level signals are not the IO, or if you want to test your design without placing pins. You can choose the virtual I/O style that you want, off, serialize using flops, serialize using LUTs, or just stub out using floating LUTs. Again, this is really only needed if you aren't going to be using I/Os in your design. You can optionally push flops into the I/O paths, either automatically, disable it, or manually. In the place and route options, we've got a few here too. You can choose the place and route mode to either be timing driven, giving you best timing results, or optimized for runtime. That would be the fast mode. The PNR seed here sets the initial random state of the place and route algorithm. You can change this to vary slightly the results. You can set the placement effort to low, which will have a faster runtime, or to high, which will have improved quality of results, but results in a longer runtime. The router hold violation fix limit allows you to set the maximum hold time violation in picoseconds that the router will fix. For more information on these advanced features, refer to the ACE user guide or use the help menu. Moving on to report generation, here you can simply check which reports you want to have automatically generated. Under timing analysis, you can set the number of critical paths reported per clock group, the number of worst paths per endpoint reported, whether to report unconstrained paths, and also whether to report asynchronous clear preset paths. It should be noted that any change you make to your implementation options does require that you save the project and rerun the flow for that implementation. Now that we've gone over some advanced design options, let's check out how to explore the best options for your design by using our multiprocess flow. Achronix's multiprocess flow allows users to explore different options and run them in different implementations to find which options give the best performance. Users can either have ACE generate the optimal implementations based on the device used, or you can simply run a seed sweep across the design. The netlist and device remains constant, but you can choose different constraint files or place and route options across the different implementations. The best implementation result propagates to the top of the results list. Now, let's try it out on a real design and get a better idea of how it works. We've run our project through once with the options we chose, and now let's open the multiprocess flow tab. First, we can choose the number of parallel jobs to run. It can be anywhere from 1, where all jobs are run serially, or up to 16 implementations run at the same time. For this one, since I'm running on a single machine, I'm just going to choose 1. Notice the checkbox here to enable a job submission system. If you have a grid of servers that you can run multiple implementations on, you can open up the preferences to set up your job submission command and any arguments. Next, you can choose which flow steps and at which flow step each implementation stops. For example, I'm having it stop after post-route timing analysis. This is going to bring us through place and route and give us the timing performance numbers. Next, we'll select the implementations to run. Here, you can create your own implementations using existing implementations, or you can let ACE generate some by itself. We'll click on the refresh options set to have ACE determine which device we're using and generate implementation options based on that. Alternatively, you could choose the seed sweep of prime numbers. Now that our implementations have been generated, we can select which of them in the group we want to run, and then kick it off. You can select all, deselect all, go in and check which ones you want to run. Once you've chosen all the implementations you want to run, click on Start Selected, and all the implementations will be generated and start running in order. Down here, you can find the multiprocess run logs and watch them live as they complete. Over in the editor window, you can see the multiprocess summary report. You can see which implementation is running and which ones are queued up. We'll check back when everything's done and see what the results are. And now that our run is complete, we can come and look at the results. In the editor window, we can expand the multiprocess summary report. As you can see, the best result has propagated to the top of the list. In this particular design, we haven't quite met our target. So later in this training, we'll go through our floor planner view and do some timing debug. Now let's talk about IP configuration and how that works in ACE. New for our Speedster7t devices, ACE includes our I/O Designer Toolkit to help you easily configure all the subsystems in the I/O ring. In ACE, change to the IP configuration perspective. And here, you use the IP libraries to configure the different subsystems. The GUI tool generates an ACX IP file for each interface subsystem. Once all your subsystems are configured as desired, the I/O Designer Toolkit generates all the output files, including bitstream, timing and pin constraints, wrapper files, and more. For more details, check out the I/O Designer Toolkit video on our website under training videos. Achronix also provides several soft IP cores that can be configured for use in our fabric. Each IP GUI generator creates the necessary RTL models, wrapper files, and timing constraints for the IP core, making it easy to include in your design. Now, let's open up our project and add a new soft IP core from the IP GUI generator. First, let's move to the IP configuration perspective. In the IP libraries window, go down to Speedster7t, Core, Memories, and now double-click on BRAM72K. Here, you can choose the file name. We'll just use the default and click Finish. In the GUI generator window, you can set the configuration to your specifications. The GUI will let you know if there are any warnings or errors you need to consider over in the IP problems window. So for example, if we make the byte width too big, we'll see that's an illegal property value. The information pop-up lets us know that we can select between 8-bit bytes or 9-bit bytes. For this BRAM, we're going to use a 72-bit width and a write depth of 1024. Let's go ahead and enable the output register. And if you have a memory initialization file, you can specify it here. If your IP core has several windows of configuration, you'll simply click Next to go through each page. Once you are done, save the file and click Generate. You can choose a Verilog or VHDL model, as well as where the output files will be located. Now let's look at place and route and how to use the Floorplanner view. The Floorplanner view allows users to view the actual placement and routing of the design. Let's go through all the different windows so you'll know where to find everything. The large window in the middle is the floor plan viewer, along with a flyout panel that allows users to choose what they can see in the floor plan viewer. We'll look at the flyout panel in more detail in just a few minutes. The search tool is here in the upper left. This lets you search for and highlight specific nets, pins, or instances in the design. In the upper right is the placement region window. This window allows you to highlight and manage your placement regions. And in the lower right corner is the netlist browser window. This window provides a graphical visualization of the design hierarchy. Now let's go back to our project that's been placed and routed. Remember from the multiprocess flow, our best implementation is the AutoGen 14. If you have an implementation that's already placed and routed, you can restore that implementation without having to rerun the entire flow. Simply right-click on the implementation and say Restore Implementation. Then you can choose which database you want to restore to. I'm going to choose the routed database. Now we'll quickly rerun the timing analysis and move over to the floor planner view. Simply change to the floor planner perspective, and here in the floor plan window, you can see the actual placed and routed design. One of the first tasks you might want to do is check out your worst critical path if it's missing timing targets. Notice the red indicates that we haven't met our target. Looking at our critical paths window, we can check the particular path that we'd like to highlight in the floor plan. You can see it right up here. If you double-click on the path, it'll zoom in to the actual path in question. You can zoom in either using the scroll button on your mouse, or you could also use the zoom in and zoom out keys. If you expand the flyout panel here on the right, you can add or remove layers that you wish to view. For example, we can get rid of all the non-clock nets, so it's easier to see our critical path. I'm using the selection tool now so that I can zoom in and select the starting point of the flop in the path. I'll select the starting flop and notice it turns green. I'm also going to click the selected instance fly lines. Notice how now we have some blue fly lines coming out from the starting flop. This will tell us what the flop is connected to, so we can look at it and see if the flop has been placed well or if it needs improvement. Restoring the non-clock net layer, you can look at the routing and see if there's any issue with congestion. Another feature is the critical path diagram. This tab represents your chosen critical path in a simple graphical flow diagram. You can easily see the types of logic in the path, flops, LUTs, ALUs, and the delay in between each level of logic. You can see the fanout, and you can see the instance names and net names as you zoom in. Another feature available is the search function. Let's say now I want to search for other instances that might be related to this critical path. In the search box, I can search for a pattern and check the type of element I want to search for. In this case, let's do a search for read data stream. I'll use wildcards and I'll look for only the instances. Now going back to the floor planner, we can see all of these instances highlighted in green. Another method to search or find instances is using the netlist browser here on the right. For example, I can expand the module name to see the modules and instances in the hierarchy under it. Additionally, I can right-click on a module name, choose a new highlight color, and then highlight it. Here you can see all the instances now in yellow. Sometimes in a design, you might need to restrict certain instances or modules to a specific region. In this case, you can use the Placement Region tool to create a region. Then in your PDC Placement Constraints file, you can add specific instances to this placement region. If you would like to use the Floorplanner tool to create your placement region, you simply click on the Placement Region tool, and you can select the region that you want to choose. You give it a name, you can snap to the clock region boundaries, or snap to just the tile boundaries. You can change the coordinates if you want, or leave it as the region that you've chosen. Then click on Finish, and you'll have your new region. Now that we've gone through the floor planner view, I just have a few more things to go over on routing. As I showed you before, ACE gives you the ability to restore a place and route from a previous run. You can either right-click on the implementation to restore it, or go through the file and choose Restore Implementation. ACE also provides a manual routing mode. This enables users to route or unroute specific nets. For example, in the Tickle console, you can run the command run unroute. Based on the argument, this will remove all or part of the routing. Afterwards, you can manually type runRoute to incrementally route the remaining nets. This brings us to the end of the ACE Place and Route training. Now you should know the ACE flow steps, flow options, and be familiar with some of the advanced features. You should have a basic understanding of how to configure available soft IP and the interface subsystems in the I/O ring. You now know about some helpful debug features in the floor planner view and understand the multiprocess flow and how it can help you achieve the best performance for your design. For more details, refer to the ACE user guide on our website. For questions or support, contact us at support@achronix.com. And thank you again for choosing ACE and choosing Achronix.